John chapter 1. May I have you to stand, please? Somebody probably already said John chapter 1. Pastor, this Christmas. John chapter 1. There's a prologue taking place here in John chapter 1, really verses 1 through 18, the birth and the preparation of Jesus, the Son of God. But somebody has missed something. I believe people have missed this text about Christmas. And there it reads, and you almost can see it without me reading it. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness. And the darkness has not overcome it. I'm going to stop there. I probably will not get out of John chapter 1, verse 1. But if you stay with me just a little while, we'll be going home to celebrate this week of Christmas. Our Father and our God, the person, the power, and the purpose of Christmas is found in these first five verses of this text. We thank you for bringing us thus far along the way. Our heads are now bowed, and I pray every heart is humbled with their mind stayed on thee. I made mistakes, I've fallen short, and yet your grace, your mercy, your steadfast love has looked beyond my weaknesses and my frailties, my mishaps, and you saw something in me that I never saw in myself. So now, God, I ask you to forgive me of my sins and forgive everyone who's listening to the sound of my voice. When they look back over the years and look at where they were and look at where they are now, they can say, if it had not been for the Lord on my side. We're coming now, God, as we begin to celebrate the birth of your only begotten Son. And at that birth, you said that whosoever believe in him shall have eternal life everlasting. So now, Father, in the name of thy Son, Jesus, we have family members who have been sick. We have family members who are traveling. We have a world that's been turned upside down. But you've been keeping us. And for those families that are grieving around the world, God, have mercy upon them. The truth of the matter, God, some of the people in America who have died, they didn't have to die. We're not putting that on you, because we know you are the final decision. But if they had done some things that should have been done, the truth of the matter is many of them could have still been alive. But Lord, we thank you now that you've given us a way out. We thank you, God, that you've been going to keep us and sustain us in spite of what we go through. And so, Lord, now we just want to say thank you. For the food that's on our table, the clothes that's on our back, the roof over our head, our children. We thank you, God, for our jobs. We thank you in the midst of this crisis. We pray now you shall bless us and keep us. Now allow me, God, to share this word briefly. that they may hear from you and never from me, that they may see you and not me, because I don't deserve to be standing here. But it was your choice, and you said, do what I say do, and I'll work the rest out. So, Lord, help them now to understand your word, to apply it to their life. In Jesus' name I pray, amen, and thank God. Maybe see in the presence of God. This gospel is not, the gospel of John is not a traditional text for Christmas. John is not talking about a manger, a shepherd, or a genealogy of Christ found in Matthew chapter 1. No birth narrative is in here. No host of heavenly angels showing up and singing a song. John here is not talking about an angelic appearance to shepherds watching over their flock. This is not a traditional gospel for Christmas time. Work with me if you can. John do not try to run around anyway. He don't try and run around and stuff. He gets straight to the meat of the matter in this scripture. John does not do as the other gospels writers do, but gives us the greatest delivery of all time into human context. Did y'all hear what I said? And then here, this prologue is really John 1:1-18, captures the attention of the intellectual Christian community like none other. Now, what I mean by that, can't allow me to go back in the history for a little while here. During the first 3 centuries of church history, I was just recently writing a paper about some of this, and this prologue summarizes how the word Jesus was with God in the beginning. That's significant that you understand that in the beginning was the what? I got a few Bible reasons up in here. That's good to know. He came into time, and as the Son of God was sent into history, he was the nature of God that arrived miraculously and purposely disclosed to humanity as both divine and human. Ha ha. Stay with me for a moment here to set this up. This scripture, John 1:1-18, is where the early church developed their theology of the Logos. Help me here now. In Christianity, Logos, Christianity, the understanding of Christ as the Word. That's important that you know that. Christ is the Word. Help me here. Jesus' last name is not Christ. I'm going to say that again. Jesus' name is what? Not Christ. Prove it to me, Pastor. Prove it to me, preacher. Talk to me, preacher. Jesus' name, Christ, is the Greek name for the Hebrew name for the Messiah. Help me here. I just proved that. Jesus is the Word of God. Greek logos means a thought, a concept. Help me here. The expression Dr. Terry Anderson teaches would say, as the utterance of a thought in the logos, the Word is embodied with all divine wisdom. In the beginning of the, I guess you would have to stop by Proverbs Earth and say that wisdom was right there when Jesus was there. I don't have time to go into that part, but that's where you can find it at here. So this way, Jesus is the collective thought of God. Y'all hear what I just said? Jesus is the what? Collective thought of God. And since it's the collective thought of God here, you understand? Let us look at the person of Christmas, the person of Christmas. And I may never get to the power, I may never get to the purpose, but let's look at the person, and certainly not out of John chapter 1:1 for Christ. I won't get no further. It's just too much in here, too much meat in this chapter 1, verse 1. When you look at the exegesis of John, verse 1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. That's important. In the beginning was a canonical. Let me say that. It was a canonical. Canonical. That means it was the scripture. I mean, it was the Bible. It was the Holy Scripture. Linked from John's gospel to the Hebrew scripture. Yeah, help me here. Listen to Clef. Genesis chapter 1 says what? In the beginning. Yeah, yeah. John chapter 1 says in the beginning. Yeah, there's a canonical collection here. Connection between the light and Genesis and the light. In John chapter 1, work with me here, Ken. God, it says here, Genesis 1, God said, let there be what? Oh, y'all on it. I got some Bible readers in here. John chapter 1 verse said, and the light did what? Showed up. Y'all with it now. Y'all on it. I got some teeth. No, the light of creation, but the light of redemption. Y'all hear what I just said? See, in Genesis chapter 1, it was the light of creation. In John chapter 1, it's the light of redemption. You ought to get your clap on for that one. Can I teach you a little bit more here? In the beginning was the Word, and it does not imply that the Word had a beginning. That's not what it's implying. What was the Word? And it means the Word has always existed. Y'all hear what I just said? The Word has always existed. In the beginning was the Word, but the Word had always existed. The Word was in the scripture in the Greek. Shows us an imperfect. Go back, pull some Greek up. Not much, but I got a little bit. The Word was in the scripture in the Greek. Shows us an imperfect tense, signifying an action of the past that continues in the present. Work with this. To read it accurately, in the beginning was, in the beginning is, and in the beginning always will be the Word. I hope y'all got that. I hope you got that. I hope you got that now. So we sang, "Oh, little town of Bethlehem." But Bethlehem is where Jesus was born, but not where he began. Y'all hear what I said? It's where he was born, but it's not where he what began. Work with me, Ken, if you can here. Christ the Messiah has not a beginning. He is God, agent in creation. When God said, "Let us make man in our image and in our likeness," Jesus was present in the beginning. Jesus is God eternally. In the beginning was the Word, and he did not begin at Bethlehem. He is God's co-agent, one who exercises the ruling power in God's kingdom. You do remember, don't you? It says that after he died, that he would go back and he would be with God and sit on his right-hand side. And there he would intercede for all of us. And he would be the ruling power in heaven. Talk to me if you can. Just trying to. So if you understand that, Jesus is God co-regent. Jesus is God in the flesh. Jesus always was, and there never was a time when Jesus was not. Y'all hear what I just said? Just wasn't a time that he was not. As a student of scripture and history and others who should know or might know, I some of y'all are students of the text, and after writing my recent paper on the Western Church, I recall the first council of the church almost through that was held during the reign of Constantine in Constantinople. Constantine is the modern day Istanbul and Turkey today. And so during Constantine's reign, stay with me, there was a man by the name of Arius. Yes. And Arius, he had an argument and said there was a time when the sun was not. Arius said basically that the Son of God was not the Son of God. Help me here now. And that's heresy to the max. But there was another man when they convened this council in Nicaea in the 300s to argue the preexistence of Jesus Christ. And when they argued this, it said that Arius debated with Athenaeus, and Athenaeus presented the theological argument of homoousia, that is important that I tell you that before I can finish this sermon today. Homoousia is that Jesus Christ is essential. If anybody's sitting up in here and you don't think that Jesus Christ is essential in your life, you are not a Christian. You can't walk without Jesus. You can't talk without Jesus. You can't get up in the morning without Jesus. You can't sing without Jesus. You can't see without. He is what? Essential. So he argues that Jesus Christ is essential, eternal, and equal with God. So not only is Jesus Christ essential, but Jesus Christ is eternal, and Jesus Christ is also equal with God. There never was a time when Jesus was not hold to the thoughts of our thoughts. We must always think about Jesus. At Bethlehem, he shows up, but he was already Jesus before Bethlehem. Pick it up so you can lay it down with someone else if you can. Born in Bethlehem, but he was in the beginning. Do I have a few people in here, few witnesses in here this morning? I want you to really know who and what you are celebrating for Christmas. That's why I'm talking about in the beginning. The beginning was the Word, and He is God eternally. Walk with me through the text. At Christmas time, He came to bring eternity in the midst of our time. Oh, Lamb of God, help me, Holy Spirit, here. Help me. Dr. Anderson tells us he would teach us a story about a postman, a mailman, who lost his wife 2 months before Christmas in a tragic accident. Sister Green, if you're listening to me today, Deacon Gardner, Sister Melton, Sister Wes, Sister and Brother Catherine, and Ronald Harris, and your children, Sister Angela Wilson, and family, the Kimbrough family, Sister Shields, and Deacon Gillis, and Brother Keith Thomas, and Sister B. Thomas, and Sister Prendle, and listen closely, Alexa and Aaliyah, brothers and Sister Smith, and Pastor Nix, listen to me very carefully. This postman lost his wife in a tragic accident 2 months before Christmas. Listen carefully. You all lost a loved one this year or recently, and they're not here to celebrate with you this Christmas. Listen to me carefully. The postman lost his wife tragically 2 months before Christmas, but this postman had a little daughter, a little girl, and every night he would come home and go to bed and cry himself to sleep because he lost his wife tragically 2 months before Christmas. Get up and go to work, and the next day, trying to work himself to death to forget about his pain. He was going through the grief that he had, was experiencing because of the tragic death of his wife 2 months before Christmas. To all of you in the world and to all of you whose name I just called who lost a loved one this year, listen. He took an extra job at the post office to sort lost mail during Christmas time, that where he lost, and one day when he was sorting mail, work with me here, he picked up a letter that had his address on it. All right. And he saw it was written in his daughter's handwriting. This little girl was 7 years old. His little 7-year-old daughter had written a letter to Santa Claus. Work with me if you can. Let me make sure you get it. He opened this letter, and she said, "Dear Santa, my mother died 2 months ago, and every night my daddy come home crying himself to sleep. She said, the only thing that will bring healing to him is eternity." Say this again. He read the letter that his 7-year-old daughter wrote to Santa Claus. And she said, Sister Melton and family, that the only thing that will heal my father is the healing to him is eternity. She asked Santa, "Can you bring eternity to him at Christmas?" Did you miss that? Santa, can you bring eternity to him at Christmas? Did you get that? Santa Claus, can you bring eternity to him at Christmas? I stopped by to tell you, I know you're gonna be lonely. I know you had some crying days. I know you missed your loved one, your mothers and your husbands and all that, but God sent Santa Claus by the name of Jesus. And that eternity that he brought with you can give you the healing that you need in this time of Christmas. Help me here. Whatever your brokenness is, whatever has shackled you in 2020, whatever is wrong, whatever is hurting your heart, whatever your grief may be, God brought eternity in the midst of time at Christmas. Every time we celebrate this year, eternity intersects time. For the first time in human of the baby resembling the mother is resembling the baby. For the first time in history, we get the opportunity to look down at heaven. For he came down and they placed him in a manger. And they was able to come in and look down at heaven because heaven had came down from up there. Help me, somebody. Time. Can I finish this text here? Now, I want to teach you to have a different perspective about Christmas. In the beginning was the what? Word. And the word, what? Was God. And the word, oh, help me here. And time and eternity intersect at Bethlehem and Judea. Not because he was born there, but because he was given there. God gave us his only. Yeah, y'all got the text. I got a few more Bible readers up in here. I want to finish this. But because he was given there, unto us a child is given. God's only begotten son, that whosoever believe in him shall have the everlasting eternal life. He is eternally God. And never was a time he was not. That was the argument I wrote about the Arminianism. This is the same argument the Jehovah Witnesses have. They are Arminians. And they say Jesus is a God. Hear what I say? A God. A little G-O-D God. That's what they say. They don't see Jesus as the Son of God. The term Jehovah. Islam don't see Jesus as the Son of God. They see him as a God. And so they say Jesus is a God, a small g. But this is not what the scripture says. The scripture says, in the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God. Lord, not yet, Lord. Lord, please. The Word was with God. And the Word was God. I need to close this argument with you in celebrating Christmas this year. We are celebrating what already was. Y'all hear what I just said? We celebrating what already was. In the Greek syntax, can I go back there to a little Greek here for a minute here because it helps you understand? In the Greek syntax, when there is a normative predicate noun, a normative predicate noun. See, when I was in school, I didn't like it because I didn't want to be bothered with all them verbs and adverbs and adjectives and all of that. And then when I got into seminary, I wish I had paid attention to Dr. Adams at James Weldon Johnson. He's curly hair Adams. He had to be the meanest teacher in the school. He got my attention because I passed his class. Don't get me wrong, but I really didn't like English. I was a history man. I didn't want to be bothered with science. But I wish I hadn't got it. But when you look at this normative predicate noun that precedes a definite verb, there is no need for a definite article. Just a little lesson here. Watch it. When Dr. Anderson mentioned this, I had a flashback in my Greek class. The definite articles such as a or the in Greek. Somebody getting ready to help me preach here in a minute. Watch what happened here. There is no need in Greek syntax whenever there is a normative predicate noun that precedes the definite verb. There is no need for the definite articles of a or the, so there is not a God, and he is not even the God. Listen to what I'm saying. This says that a God, G-O-D, and he is not even the G-O-D. Jesus is just God. He's not a God. He's not
the God. Help me here. He is God. So in the beginning was the word God. And so don't be trying to fit. He just God. He's just, everybody say God. That's who he is. In the beginning was I am trying to bless you to get over some of this stress you had. Jesus is God eternally. And secondly, in John verse 1, Jesus is God equally. Almost there. The word was with God. God equally called the word because it is an invisible expression of an invisible thought. What are you talking about, Pastor? I ain't trying to get theological. Let me help you out. Because you just don't think about it, but you do it every day. You do this every day. Let me draw you closer. Think about it. Whenever you speak a word, you birth a thought. I say hello, I just birthed a thought. I say get out of my face, I just birthed a thought. So the word birthed a thought. Listen to me now. What you say is what you sent forth. Jesus is God expressing a thought. Jesus came down. Okay, but why did he come? He was placed in a manger. But why did they place him there? Mary was a virgin who birthed Jesus. How did that happen? Jesus birthed a thought just by calling it. Who is this? Oh, man. Jesus is God sending forth the mind of God, the nature of God. I'm almost there. The Logos, the visible expression of an invisible thought. The Word was God. And God means he was face to face with God. See, I just said Jesus. Jesus is God. And he was face to face with God. Again, now I'm going to use this word again and I'm going to be through with it. Homoousia. They are of the same essence. That was the argument back in the day. Who is God? Who is Jesus to God? And so Jesus is not a demigod. He's not a semi-god. He's not a junior god. Jesus is just God. Oh, y'all almost with me. I think I didn't lose you. So that's good. If I didn't lose you, I guess. He was with God, face to face with God, and said, let us make man in our image, in our likeness. Imago Dei. If I am in the image of God, and I'm made like God, why should I stress about things that are going on in the world? Because God didn't stress anything. Oh, man. See, I was listening to the song that he was singing. Jesus was the one whom Jesus was talking about. God himself, Jesus, is the speech of God. Jesus is the thought of God. Help me here. Jesus is God's agent at creation. Yeah. God's smoke that appeared between the two cherubims. He was the stone in David's slingshot. Help me here. Jesus is the pillar of cloud by day. Jesus is the pillar of fire by night. Help me here. Jesus is the Shekinah cloud that rested in the tabernacle when the children of God were in the wilderness. That's who Jesus is. Jesus is God saying something. Well, what do you mean he's saying something, Pastor? To every committed Christian, this morning during this Christmas, God is still saying something. Got off Judea of Bethlehem and was saying, though your sins are scarlet, they will become white as snow. God is still saying something. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? God is still saying something. He is the root of David. The Lord is still saying something. The Lord is my shepherd. He said, therefore, I shall not want. God is still saying something. He is the life in the light of the world. That's who got off at Judea of Bethlehem, and he is still saying something. But finally, I want to say before I close, there was a man by the name of Dr. Evans Crawford. He was the dean of chaplains at Howard University. He was 96 years old when God called him home last year. But he coined a terminology. He coined a term for black preachers called homiletical musicality. Man, what kind of stuff is that? Here he is, a homiletical musicality. What is he saying? He's saying that there was a time, so those of you here are 50 years and older, you remember a time when you were in a church, you didn't have no carpet. Help me here. And when people started singing, you started tapping your feet, and you could hear the cadence of the homiletical musicality going on in the church. Help me, Dr. Crawford, here. You would begin to clap your hands because you would hear the homiletical musicality going on inside the church. You would sing one of those hymns when the deacons would get up in front of you and say, a charge to keep our head, a God to glorify. You would start singing a homiletical musicality. I stopped by to tell you something here, and I want to make sure you understand this. When he's playing and they're playing, and I stop the music and I ask the drummer to just give me a beat, and the next thing you know, y'all start moving a little bit, and then y'all start clapping your hands a little bit. You start doing the homiletical musicality. And I know this year has been hard. I know it has been difficult. I know you have lost a loved one, but I want you to help you out. I want you to get your homiletical musicality back on. When you're sitting home for Christmas, and it's Christmas Eve, and you feel like you're all by yourself, you need to hum a little bit. Oh my God, when you hum, and you need to start thinking about the goodness of the Lord. Have I got a witness here? When I preach, and I say, say amen, I'm getting a homiletical musicality back from you. When I say, lift up your hands and praise the Holy God, I'm getting a homiletical musicality back from you. When they're singing those songs and you're clapping your hand, you start moving like you never thought you could move before. That's because the Holy Spirit come down. Help me, Dr. Crawford, and give you a homiletical musicality moment in your life. Have I got a witness here? When you clap your hand, the voice is ringing out in the cadence with the preachers. Some say, preach, pastor. That's just a homiletical musicality coming back to me. You know what the text is saying? I put out, you put things back. A homiletical musicality mean I call to get a recall. Have I got a witness here? If you love the Lord, say amen. That's the call, and I got a recall. So when I'm putting out, you ought to put back. When Jesus came down, God put out so we could put back. He said, I didn't just send him down here just for you to look at. I sent him down here for you to have a musicality moment with him. He said, call on Jesus and he shall what? Hear and what? Answer your prayer. That's a musicality moment in your life. I need to close this thing. He said, was singing deep. I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. But it says here this Christmas, you need to get your homiletical musicality back on. If you're home alone, just sing
a song and get it on. If you're troubled, get your hum back. And you're getting your hum on. The devil don't understand what you're saying. When you hear me saying, oh, I know he's all right. That's just my way of saying, I'm getting my homiletical musicality back on. Because in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. When I say something, you ought to say something. When I say something, you ought to say something. It is called in the response. It is the back and the forth that goes on only in the black church. You can't go to any other church and get this homiletical musicality back on. Has God ever done anything for you? Say yeah. Did God pick you up and turn you around? Say yeah. Do you love the Lord? Say yeah. That is a call, and I'm looking for a response. Stop me, somebody here. Something's happening in eternity past. God said something, and then Jesus said something. Here's what happened. God spoke, and he came into existence. He said, let there be, and everything that was got started. Have I got a witness here? In Genesis, he said, in the beginning was bring the light. In Genesis, in John chapter 1, the light showed up. It's a back and forth response, even with God and with Jesus. They had their own homiletical musicality. I'm almost through, but hang in here just a little bit longer. Always, it was back and forth. Do you remember when Jesus got ready to feed somebody? He would go off and he would have a little talk with the Father. But after he talked with him, he called and God responded. Come Christmas Eve, come Christmas Day, if you by yourself, get on your knees, have a little talk with the Master, you call, I guarantee you, God will respond. You just gotta do it in Jesus' name. Stop by to tell you here, there's a drum beat. This call and response, because you know who I know. Do you know the same man that I know? Do you know what this man will do for you? You know how many generations he came down. Do you know when he came down after 42 generations, got off Judea, Bethlehem, he changed the whole world. You know who I met. And if you have met the same man, say yes. I stopped by to tell you, you've been going through a lot of things. You say something, at least you ought to, because God been good to you. I don't see how anybody who served the same God that I serve can sit down. When you think about the goodness of the Lord, when you think about the Word, when you think about the Logos, when you think about he was already there before he showed up, but man wanted somebody to prove something to them. So God said, wrap yourself up in human flesh. Go on down and get off of Judea of Bethlehem. And when he got off there, I stopped by to tell you, here's the reason why you ought to respond when I call. The Lord, your cancer you had, you called and God responded and now it's gone. COVID-19 came in. We prayed and God heard our prayer. Now God is responding to our need. Christ has come, and already since he came, he set things up. I came to tell you, you gotta be happy and not worry, because you got God on your side. God said something, you say something. He said something, well, this morning, Gandhi, what did he say? He said, get up out of that bed. He said, get up and walk heaven, how many people would love to get up out of their bed and be able to dress themselves? We don't always get it right, but I stop by to tell you, when you call, God will respond. That's what happened. The world was sinning and they needed a savior. So in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God all by himself. Oh, I know he's all right. Do you know he's all right? If you know he's all right, say yeah. He died on another man's cross. He died for early one Sunday morning. He got back up. Didn't he get up and save our lives? And when he got up, I got some new hope. I got some new love. I got some new peace. When you call, weeping may endure for a night, but early, early, early Sunday morning, you can get back up. Won't he do it? Won't he make a way? Say yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, I know he's all right. That's homiletical musicality. Sometimes you just gotta hum it out. Mother Melton, I know you're hurt, I know you're struggling, but I know he's all right. How about a witness here? Sometime you just gotta hum it out. Brother Mel Press, I know you've been going through it, but you gotta get your hum back on. Oh Lord, oh Lord. Oh, I know he's all right. Ah, Lord. Ah, Lord. Ah, Lord. Why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Y'all know that, don't you? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home when Jesus is my portion? Have I had a witness here? Is he your portion? My constant friend is he. The text just say, keep your eyes on the sparrow. And I know he's watching over me. Listen to me. This is a Christmas that you're celebrating at the end, in the coming end of a major pandemic. But God is still intersecting in history. Keep calling, and he'll keep on responding. Because in the beginning was the what? Word. And the Word what? All right. God bless you. We're going to open the doors of the church. And I'm going to pray that I can do what we need to do. I will
trust.
The doors of the church open. You can come as a candidate for baptism. You can come by letter. You can come by Christian experience.
I will
may we pray to bless our offering.
May we pray. Father God, we thank you for all that you've done and all that you're going to do. Oh, Father God, we pray right now in your holy name. That's the only way we know how to pray. Oh, Father God, now we come to give back to you, Lord, which you loaned us. And Father God, we pray that you take it and bless it, sanctify it, and use it for your building, your church. Oh, Father God, we ask you to bless those that wanted to give, and maybe they didn't have to give this time. But Father God, we pray that you work it out, that they may be able to give next time. We know that you're able. The whole world is in your hands. So, Father God, we know that you can work it out. So we thank you right now. Bless this offering for your kingdom. In Jesus' holy and righteous and wonderful name. Amen. Amen.
So feel I'm gonna stay on the battlefield. I am gonna stay on.
I'm gonna treat everybody right. Come on, y'all. Yeah.
I am gonna treat it.
You may be seated in the presence of Almighty God. Isn't God good? Haven't he been good to you?
I am going to stay on the back.
All right, I believe we have some presentations. Let's do the presentations quickly. Then we will have the male chorus to come and close us out. Choir, you can go down and have a seat and relax and chill out. I was told don't leave the men this year. I was told to stay up here with them. And Slim, she told me to tell you to do the same thing. Ministers and pastors, y'all can go down and find you a seat where you can sit distantly. Come quickly with the presentations. Now, after Deacon Jones, right there. Make sure that the kids get one of those. Anything that's left, leave it there because we're going to give the rest of those toys and things to somebody in the community, okay? Thank you, sir. First thing she did, she went down there and she hurried up and she slid right next to her man. She got as close as she...
This Bible was left in the female's bathroom. If it's your Bible, it's sitting up here for Deacon Gillis.
It's a nice looking Bible.
Merry Christmas, everybody. I just wanted to give honor to God who's ahead of my life and to my pastor, to the pulpit, Pastor McCullough, Pastor McGrady, Pastor Nix, Minister Irvin, and everyone in your respective places. I have a few people that I want to bless and acknowledge. Number four. Okay. I want to give back. God has been good to me, and I just wanted to be a blessing to those that have touched my life in this ministry. And as I call your names, could you please come up? It's just a little token of my love. Sister Nicole is not here. Pastor McCullough. Thank you, sir. Merry Christmas. Thank you. Sister Monet is in the back. She's a part of the singles ministry. We talk, have become really good friends. Sister Kimbrough, you have been a blessing to me, love. Thank you. Brother Reggie, thank you for the food. Okay. Minister Irvin, you can give it to her. Minister Irvin. No. It's a lot. Come up. Come up and get your gift. Pastor Nix, thank you. I'm not gonna cry. I'm not gonna do it. Okay, so First Lady McCullough, well, thank you for an ear. Yes, love you. What's that? Brother Joe. Thank you. God bless you. Merry Christmas. First Lady Nix, can you take that to her for me, please? Okay, well. Sister Palmer. Grady. Pastor Gundy, can you come down, please? Just stay right there. You can stay there. I know you just preached. Go ahead and rest. Andy, I just want to say that it's been a pleasure this year. You have really been a father to me in the ministry. When you saw me going down, you kind of like, with the word, thank you, sir. It's a small token of my love in front of everybody. I just want to say I love you and Merry Christmas. And that's, and First Lady is in there, so give that to her for me, please. I have some other things for other people, but I'm not calling you out. I will give that to you as I see you in the foyer or after Christmas. I'm not after Christmas, but after the service. Merry Christmas, everybody, and be safe. Amen.
Okay, let me say this to you, some of you. Mother Brown, who is, of course, as you know, in the hospital, and she has gifts that she packed up and did everything. But she said, no, Pastor, let's just wait till I get out of the hospital because I want to make sure I give them out to everybody. She's got to continue to wrap some things. But, man, she had over 70 gifts. So, but she's doing well, she's up walking. I'm trying to get them to give her that cream of rice that she loves. She don't like grits. She loves cream of rice. And so I wanted to make sure everybody know that. All things said and done, right? All right, brothers. Your time. Dean Gordon, come on up. I tell you, I'm sweating like a he getting ready to step out. That's what that is. We are down to four of us for right now. And we rehearsed and we tried to do the very best that we could.
Yes, Lord, all the time.
Work with you. See, y'all seeing him in front of you. We see him when we by ourselves. He cuts up sometimes. He's a good man, though. All of them, they really are. He has a heart of gold, and he witches as long as you're right. When you're wrong, he'll let you know. And that's what we all need. We all need accountability partners. We thought for Christmas that we would do what we normally do for you this year. We hope and pray that you will enjoy this little moment together as we say Merry Christmas to you here at the church, to those who are listening on the phone and those who are watching us viral, this is our way of saying Merry Christmas to all of you. Okay?
My Lord, I'll never find the words, my Lord,
yes,
to tell you how I feel, my Lord. Mere words could not explain. And precious Lord, you held my life within your hand, created everything I am. You taught me how to live again.
Lord, only you care when I needed a friend. Believed in me through thick and thin.
This song is for you, filled with gratitude and love.
God,
and God bless you.
Yeah, you make me.
You make me feel brand. God bless me with you. You make me feel brand new.
I sing
this song for you.
Make me feel brand new.
My Lord, whenever I was insecure, you built me up and made me sure. You gave my pride,
yeah, he did,
back to me.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did. Come on, brother.
Precious Lord, you held my life within your hand, created everything I am. You taught me how to live again.
Without you, life has no meaning or rhyme. Like notes of a song out of time.
How can I repay you for having faith in me? And God bless you.
You make me.
You make me feel brand new.
For God bless me.
For God bless me with you.
Yes, Lord.
You make me feel brand new. I sing this song for you.
Go ahead on. Praise him. Praise him. Go ahead on. Praise him.
Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Go ahead on and praise him.
Kingdom come. His will be done. All earth as it is.
That's how you praise him. That's how you praise him.
Not into temptation.
You make me feel brand new. For God bless me with you. You make me feel brand new. I sing this song of you. Make me feel brand new.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Our last selection, as you know, is the song that the two young sisters came and they sung today. It was Silent Night. I'm a little host, but I do the very best that I can. Amen.
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 It was the night before Christmas, and all through the house, not a creature was stirring,
yes, Lord.
Not even a mouse.
In my mind,
yes, sir.
I want you to be free. To all our friends, ooh, would you listen to me? Ooh, now hear what I say. Ooh, we wish you all a Merry Christmas to me,
to all of you,
one of you. Silent night.
Yes, Lord.
Sing it, Pastor. What a joyous day.
Ooh.
your mind.
Just one more time. Just one more time.
As I sit around the fireplace,
yes,
watching the gleaming trees,
homeless cold.
If I had one wish in this world, that all men would be free. That's whole hands.
Ooh,
the sin is born. Yes, he is.
Jesus
is born, yeah.
Yeah.
Sleep in heavenly. Oh, yes.
Sleep
in heaven. Heavenly.
When you moan, the devil don't know what you're moaning.
One more time.
You don't know what you're talking about.
To all my family and friends.
One more time.
Remember this line. To all my family and friends.
Merry Christmas from the Mount Sinai male chorus.
May God be the glory.
He sure get it all too. So Christmas Eve and Christmas Day, I want you to get your homiletical musicality back on and sing Merry Christmas, sing Silent Night, and yeah, just go ahead and say, just get your homiletical musicality back on. Don't let this world worry you when God got it all in his hand. Amen. I want to thank all the young people once again. I want to thank everybody who was on program today. I want to thank everybody for what you did. Thank you for all the gifts, everything that we've done. I want you to have a very merry, merry, merry Christmas. And enjoy your Christmas. Don't forget that we do have church next Sunday. I will be here, but I certainly would not be preaching. I won't be preaching until the first of the year. And then New Year's Eve, we'll announce that we'll be meeting at 6 p.m. rather than 7 p.m. for New Year's Eve service. Amen. May we all stand. To our guests today, we want to thank you for coming once again. We pray that we have said something. God has spoke to your spirit, spoke to your heart. The music has done something to uplift you during this time of the year. And to all of those who I was preaching about and you have lost someone, eternity has showed up and he can give you the peace that can surpass all understanding. It won't be easy. You're going to have some ups, going to have some downs. But when you're having that problem, get your homiletical musicality back on. Let's everybody sing. Let the church. We want to thank Brother Barry, who was our guitarist today. Let the church. God has spoken. Everybody now, come on, sing it one more time. Everybody, let the church say amen. Thank you, God, for your son.
Let the church. Let the church. Say amen. God has spoken.
Now, eternal God, our Father, we hope and pray that this worship experience was pleasing in your sight. We did it to edify that you may be glorified. We thank you for this privilege of being able to come back and serve you once again. And now, dear fathers, we prepare to leave your presence from this worship experience. It is my prayer that these thy people shall never ever leave your presence. I pray wherever they go, whatever they're doing, that somebody shall see Christ in them. I pray that you shall put your hedge of protection all around them. Now may the grace of our Father, may the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, Lord, may it rest. Lord, may it rule. Lord, may it abide with these thy people, not just now, but now, henceforth, and forevermore. Let us all sing together. Let the church say amen. Come on. Lift up your voices and praise his holy name. That's what I'm talking about. Come on, let the church say amen. Let the church. God has spoken. Church, say amen. All right. All right. All right. I say 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 all right. All right. I say all right. All right. I say all right. Yeah, Lord. Yeah, Lord. Yeah, Lord. Yeah, Lord. Nah. Ah, Lord. Make sure you get those young people. Get the young people back there in the educational annex. Hey, Doc. Get the young people back there in the educational annex. Classroom A, so they can get their Christmas gifts. They get two each. They get two each, and then that's it. All the young people. I'll be back there in a few minutes. Brother Gardner, Brother Wilbur, go get your homiletical musicality on, God. God bless you, man.